NC State nickelback Dre Wright bagged an SC top 10 highlight with a gigantic hit and fumble recovery against Troy last week.
Oh, my goodness. Look out.
Eastern Kentucky quarterback Benny Coney hopes his O-line can keep Wright out of his grill today. The Wolfpack hosts the Colonels. Starts now on ESPN3. You're watching the ACC on ESPN. It's Pack and Black Night as we welcome you to Carter-Finley Stadium in Raleigh, North Carolina, as the NC State Wolfpack seek a 2-0 start to their season hosting Eastern Kentucky of the Ohio Valley Conference. And good evening, I'm Matt Stewart, joined by former Notre Dame star running back Darius Walker. And Darius, already today, defending OVC champ Jacksonville State put a huge scare in number 6 Auburn before losing 27-20 in overtime. Well, Eastern Kentucky picked second in the conference behind Jacksonville State. Might they do the same thing here tonight against NC State?
Well, I tell you, the Colonels are definitely hopeful, but unfortunately for them, NC State is on a roll. Dating back to last season, they've won 5 out of their last 6 games, so the Pack is playing their best football right now. It's going to be interesting to see today.
Well, both of these teams love to run the football. For the second straight week, NC State, no Shadrack Thornton, and more on that later, but Jalen Samuels was a guy that really turned some heads in their opening win against Troy.
Yeah, for the Wolfpack, it's all about balance on offense, and Samuels definitely gives him that. You see the numbers there, 9.8 yards average per touch. They handed him the ball 4 times in the game last week. He scored 3 touchdowns, so expect to see number 28 tote the rock quite a bit here today. And on the flip side for Eastern Kentucky, they have the reigning offensive player of the year in the conference in Deshaun Mobley. Now, he's been slowed by the hamstring, which means Kentavious Hopkins is going to have to step up and carry some of the load here. But expect to see both guys carry the ball.
And Mobley rushed for nearly 1,500 yards last year, his first season with Eastern Kentucky, after transferring from the Kentucky Wildcats. He's one of 5 D1 transfers on that Colonels roster. It's Eastern Kentucky and NC State. Pack and Black Night here in Raleigh. Opening kick is coming up next. Welcome back to Carter-Finley Stadium in Raleigh, North Carolina. Just about set for the opening kick as Eastern Kentucky and NC State meet for just the second time. Been a threat of rain all day, but the forecast model keeps changing, and it looks like we might avoid the wet stuff altogether. We're hopeful. Currently 78 degrees with a slight breeze coming out of the west, southwest at 7 miles per hour. As I mentioned, this is just the second all-time meeting. First meeting came back in 2005. With the Wolfpack posting a 54-10 victory.
Woo.
Eastern Kentucky will receive the opening kick after NC State won the toss and deferred to the second half. Jackson Maples is set to kick things off. You see NC State in their black unis tonight. And we are underway in Raleigh. Absanon will take it at the goal line. And Stanley Absanon, one of the most dynamic players on this Colonels roster, returns it to the 22, and that's where Eastern Kentucky will start on offense for the first time tonight. Benny Coney, one of those 5 D1 transfers I was speaking about just a few moments ago, a fourth-year junior out of Plant City, Florida, by way of the University of Cincinnati, did not start last week against Valpo because of an allergic reaction, but did come in the second series, finished out the game. He was 11 for 20 for 153 and a couple of touchdown passes. Mobley is lined up next to him in the backfield. And Coney goes to the air right away. Ball is complete to the 30-yard line. Catch Beasley, the slot back, freshman out of Louisville.
Love to see the freshman getting a little bit of time to play early on in this game.
8-yard pickup for Beasley brings up a second down and two for the Colonels. And head coach Dean Hood in his eighth season as the Eastern Kentucky head coach. Coney gonna run it. Not gonna get there. B.J. Hill, the big nose tackle, dropped him in his tracks. Shy of the sticks, they actually lost yardage on the play.
Like to see the big man move there in B.J. Hill. He's just a sophomore, but he's 6'4", 300 pounds. Terry's a former running back. I would not like to have seen that guy on the other side of the line.
And Darius, NC State, very young up front, only one senior on that defensive line. And that's not just in the starting, but that is in their depth chart.
Yeah, most certainly. They got three sophomores starting alongside Mike Rose. He's number 90, the lone senior for this defensive line.
It is a third down and four from the 28. Blitz is coming. They pick it up. Coney with time throws incomplete. Trying to connect with Joel Brown, and that's going to be a three and out for the Colonels.
And that's unfortunate for the Colonels in this situation. You saw the blitz there, and the offensive line actually slid and picked it up, so they had a chance. It looks like there's also a flag down, so we'll let the White Hat sort this out.
Number six is first and sportsmanlike conduct call.
Pat Garvey is our referee, and that was Joel Brown, the intended target on the play, who was called for the unsportsmanlike penalty. So that's going to pin Eastern Kentucky deep. Means they'll be punting out of their own end zone or close to it.
You know, in these games, you mention it a lot because special teams is so key right now in these games, especially when you have a team like Eastern Kentucky playing NC State. So when you shoot yourself in the foot with something that's unnecessary like that, it really sets you back, because now we're talking field position.
So Keith Rusak, the sophomore out of Australia, stands a foot into the end zone to kick. Cherry from the 47. And Cherry picks up about 7 yards on the return before being dropped by Luke Kahlschmidt. And here come the Wolfpack on offense for the first time tonight. And they are led by their fifth-year senior, Jacoby Brissett, last week against Troy. Nearly perfect, except for an overthrow on a deep ball and an intentional throwaway. He was 21 of 23 for 196 and two touchdowns. Leads the nation in pass accuracy after 1 week, a 91%.
And he knows how to spread the ball around, too. Another number they don't talk about enough is he hit 10 different wide receivers last week. So he knows how to spread around effectively and find the open guy.
That was Days in Motion to the top of your screen. Brissett, heavy rush. Ball is out and covered by the Colonels. Fortunately, or for the Wolfpack, pardon me, Joe Tooney, the left tackle, got on top of that ball after Brissett, who had a problem with fumbles last year, got hit and dropped the ball.
Yeah, this is the matchup we're going to be checking all night, and Noah Spence right here on the edge. You mentioned the five transfers. Noah Spence is one of those guys from Ohio State.
And that was Noah Spence, as you mentioned, who jarred it loose. Brissett fumbled the ball 7 times a year ago. That was a big problem for him. Flag out on the completion of Naheem Hines.
Holding, offense number 54, 10-yard penalty, second down.
Well, that's Joe Tooney who gets flagged for the holding after he had recovered the fumble. So did something good, then did something bad.
Yeah, well, this is a classic case of Joe Tooney just really trying to block Noah Spence here. He's trying to figure out this guy. We mentioned him, the transfer from Ohio State. In 2013, he was first team all Big Ten. So Noah Spence is a guy who's an NFL-type talent. It's going to be tough for Tooney all day.
And had Noah Spence not been kicked out of the Big Ten for 2 failed drug tests, he'd probably be in the NFL already.
Most certainly.
So second down now and 28 with the ball way back at the 36-yard line as the Wolfpack going in reverse on this opening possession. That's Samuels, who we talked about in the opening with the pass catch, and he's up to the 44-yard line, picked up 8 on the play.
For NC State, it's really about trying to get some momentum going here early in this game. You hurt yourself with the penalty. You hurt yourself with the sack. Got to figure out some positivities to get momentum going on offense. And you see the impact players here for NC State, Matt Dangs. He's a versatile guy. 126 yards last week and a couple of touchdowns. And we've mentioned Noah Spence already having his impact early on in this game.
And Dangs getting his second consecutive start, with Thornton still sidelined with his two-game suspension. Pass is complete to Jamichael Ramos. And close to a first down for the Wolfpack as they get it all back after having a second and 28.
Yeah, Jamichael Ramos here, he's number 85. He's just going to run a nice little cut-in route there at the end. Brissett hits him right in stride. That's what they love about their quarterback in Brissett. He really is accurate with those passes across the middle.
Ramos, who had three catches a week ago against Troy, gets a catch here tonight, starting to show the form that he first displayed back in his freshman season with 24 catches back in 2013.
He was really good then, sort of disappeared slightly last year with his numbers.
On a first and 10, that ball is thrown complete at the 29-yard line to Ramos again.
And he's a big body guy. They really like him because he's 6'2", 200 pounds. Typically in the ACC, you're going to see smaller corners, guys that are 5'11", maybe 6 foot. So his height definitely helps them there. They want to continue to see that production out of Ramos.
That was a 7-yard pickup for Ramos, so a second down and 3 coming up for the Wolfpack from the Eastern Kentucky 29. Dangs, big hole. Slipped as he tried to make a cut and goes down at the 20-yard line, but he'll move the sticks. Grabs his helmet because Darius, you know that feeling. He saw a touchdown and he slipped.
I do. I mean, you got to see the jump cut here. Right back, wide open hole, and trying to make a guy miss. He just slipped. It might be a little bit wet, but an excellent player in Dangs. I mean, he's a guy who is so versatile. They'll throw the ball to him, obviously hand him the ball as well. He's a really good player.
First and 10 from the 20. Brissett with the run. Slides down at the 14-yard line and picks up 6 on the play. Brissett rushed for over 500 yards last year.
He most certainly did, but you see the slide there. That's something new for his game. He's not used to sliding, but he's taken a few big hits over the last course of the last few seasons, and so he's really figured out now that he's got to protect himself a little bit, even though he's got that big body, big frame at 6'4", 235.
And it is a big body and a big frame for the fifth-year senior out of Dwyer High School in West Palm Beach, Florida, by way of the University of Florida. Dangs on the cutback inside the 10, and Dangs has a first down and a first and goal to go coming up for the Wolfpack.
You know, this offensive line, I mean, when you look at the numbers here spread out all the way across the board, every guy is around 300 pounds. That's a big man. So when you talk about winning that line of scrimmage battle, that's what gives NC State so much success, specifically with running the football, because they got those big horses up there laying people down.
Head coach Dave Dorn has talked about a run to win and pass to score philosophy on offense. Says they're close to being able to do that, don't quite have the depth yet on the offensive line to be totally where he'd like to be.
How many 300-pound guys you know can move like that? So it takes a little bit of time to get those guys into the program, but they've done an excellent job so far.
Not much for Dangs on that carry right there. Brings up a second down and 8. Actually lost some yardage on the play. Dangs' first career 100-yard game rushing last week with his 126 against Troy and a couple of touchdowns. Second down and goal. Brissett gonna take it himself. Got hit at the 5 and the defender just bounced off him like a pinball.
I tell you, that's a big quarterback. Again, 6'4", 235 pounds. But Matthew Dangs, I mean, you can't talk about him enough because he's so specific and so special for this offense. Talk about a guy who rushed for over 500 yards last year, but he also catches balls out of the backfield at over 1,200 all-purpose yards. So he's a guy that can definitely tote the rock, but he can catch it. He is a matchup nightmare, as they say, in the running back position.
Told reporters the game reminded him of high school back in his days at Cypress Bay High School in Weston, Florida. Third down and goal now from the six. And the play gets whistled dead.
Play again. Offense. 5-yard penalty. Third down.
NC State has not been quite as sharp in this opening possession as they were last week against Troy, where they were nearly flawless with no offensive penalties and no turnovers.
Well, that was kind of the weird thing about the game last week, was that you didn't see a lot of those week one mistakes, the offsides, the penalties. You didn't see that. So we might see some of that here today since they didn't do it last week.
So now third down and goal from the 11. Brissett. In trouble, he'll go down, tried to get rid of it. He's going to be down at the 15-yard line. Quarterback sacked by Avery Pitt.
Yeah, this is an excellent job by Avery Pitt getting in, but this really started on the back end. The Eastern Kentucky defense, they call it a coverage sack because no one was open, and Brissett looks to try to find a guy. Goes to that third read, has to take it down and run. Forces a fourth down situation, so this is a big win for Eastern Kentucky here.
Brings on the freshman, Kyle Bambard. His first field goal attempt. 7 of 7 on PATs last week against Troy. This is a 33-yard kick. And the kick was blocked. And that is one of the specialties of this Eastern Kentucky team, a team that blocked 7 kicks last year to lead the OVC and finished 7th in the NCAA FCS. And they block a kick here tonight to keep NC State off the board in their opening possession.
Again, special teams is so key in this game for Eastern. As you see, Devin Borders gets up and makes the block. They're excited to see him out there. He had some hamstring issues that he was dealing with, but it's good to see him. But special teams going to be key in this game for Eastern Kentucky.
And Darius, Devin Borders is their blockologist. He had 5 blocks, 5 of their 7 blocks by number 88, Devin Borders, last year, and he gets one here tonight.
That size helps. It's 6'6", 220 pounds. He's also a wideout for him, too, for look for them to throw him the football.
Let me tell you, if you can do that, someone might get you on their NFL roster just for that.
You most certainly do have a
chance. If you've got a specialty like that, you might have a living. So first and 10 now for the Colonels at the 20-yard line, still scoreless after a couple of possessions in this game. Nothing doing right there. NC State met the challenge at the line of scrimmage, and they slam Mobley to the ground.
Eastern's going to try to find a way to get Mobley involved. We talk about him at the top. I mean, he's the reigning conference player of the year, 1,400 yards rushing last year. And he had the hamstring injury in camp, so he was slowed, really trying to get his wind back up, get back in game shape, as they say.
Mobley again, chased to the outside, and he barely gets back to the original line of scrimmage as Hakeem Jones, the senior free safety, drags him down.
You know, we have yet to see Eastern do anything vertical right now in terms of the passing game. Still early on in this game, but you got to take your shots when you can. Now is a tough time to do it because everyone knows that you're going to pass.
Third down and 10, Darius. Eastern Kentucky looking at their second consecutive 3-and-out unless they can pick up 10 yards here. Coney off his back foot throws to Borders over there on the side. Incomplete. And it's going to be fourth down.
That's a good job by Justin Burris there, covering up the wide receiver.
Yeah, good luck picking on Burris, making his 30th consecutive start, which is the longest streak on the team.
He is an experienced veteran.
Dave Doran in his third season. This team has really kind of flipped the switch. They've won 5 of their last 6 games, Darius, dating back to last season after going 7-13 in Doran's first 20 games.
Yeah, so they really have found something here, and it's been a combination of getting the right talent and then guys buying into the system.
Rusak standing at his 5-yard line to punt this time, a little bit of an improvement after punting out of his own end zone the first time around. Averaged 50 yards a kick last week against Valpo. Cherry retreats all the way back to the 25. Ah, we're going to have a block in the back, going to bring this one back, so Cherry might as well rest.
Don't burn yourself out, young man. Don't burn yourself out.
Cherry finally goes down at the 25, but it's all for naught, folks. Block in the back, way back at the 28-yard line. That was a 55-yard kick by Rusak.
And look at again at how special teams is having such an impact on this game. First, Eastern blocks the field goal, and now NC State shoots themselves in the foot with a block in the back here. Special teams coming up key.
During the return, we were blocking the back by the receiving team on the 10. 10-yard penalty. First down. TV timeout.
Well, let's take another look at it right here.
Yeah, they're going to get number 10, Freddie Phillips Jr. here. Just. We'll be right back. Big drop there because he was wide open. Looked like a busted coverage there for Eastern Kentucky. You got to have those. Early on in this game, 0-0. Trying to build momentum, you got to make those plays.
And that is the first incompletion for Brissett in this ball game, and just his third of the season. That one wasn't his fault. Second down and 10. Day slips a couple of tackles. Gains about three on the play.
I tell you, for running backs, it's all about those yak yards. Yards after contact. And the thing that I love about Days is there's always one guy that gets to him, the first guy, but he never gets him. He always gets past the first guy.
Led the team with 1,278 all-purpose yards a year ago. His 13 total touchdowns, ranked third in the ACC, 8 rushing touchdowns, 5 receiving touchdowns. As you pointed out, Darius, very versatile back. And Shadrack Thornton is eligible to come out of his suspension next week when they play at Old Dominion. Downfield, complete, across midfield, and that's Ramos again. What a story Jamichael Ramos has been for NC State here early in this season.
He is really coming on right now, and he's number 85. Watch the block, though, by Days. That's where it starts to give a quarterback enough time, but an excellent route and throw. This combination is looking good right now for Brissett Ramos.
Did you say Ramos in the doghouse last year? 24 catches as a freshman in 2013. Only one catch all of last year as a sophomore. He considered transferring, but now he's got 2 catches here tonight and 5 total in their first 2 games.
You know, sometimes when you get knocked down, the question really is how do you respond? And I think we're seeing that in Jamichael Ramos, in that he understands that he's got the opportunity to play now, and he's going to take advantage of that opportunity.
Second down and 9. Dorn was very complimentary of the fact that Ramos overcame the adversity last season, stuck with the program, played hard. We might have a fumble on the play. Eastern Kentucky says they have it, and the ball's going over to the Colonels.
Like,
how about that?
We got our first turnover.
Yeah, it's really interesting. You touched on this earlier. NC State doing all the things wrong that they didn't do in the first week against Troy.
They didn't do it, and you got to think that it's because it's the beginning of the season and you typically have those. But Day's a short-handed guy.
It was Nichols actually on the carry. DeQuay Nichols fumbled. It was Devontae Derricott, the transfer from Kansas State, who stripped the ball from him. The Colonels will have it when we get back. No score here with 2:39 to play in the opening quarter. Upon further review, it was Devontae Derricott, Dino Montgomery, and Chris Kelly on the strip of DeQuay Nichols. But it was Noah Spence, number 9, the Ohio State transfer, who fell on top of the ball. And gives the Colonels the ball at their own 42-yard line, their best field position. That's Adam Lane, the transfer from Florida, getting the early carry, as he picks up about 3.5 on the play. As we take a look at the 5 D1 transfers on the roster for Eastern Kentucky: Noah Spence, Devontae Derricott, Benny Coney, Deshaun Mobley, and Adam Lang, who transferred in mid-August.
Yeah, just recently. He just got there. It's good to see him out there. They're high on this guy.
He was the MVP for the Florida Gators in the Birmingham Bowl back in December, left the Gators program in mid-August and transferred to Eastern Kentucky, a team the Gators beat last year 52-3. Must have saw some
that
opportunity.
Yeah.
I said, I could help these guys out.
You know what? I could get on that field. Gotta love it, though. But Coach Hood has done an excellent job in getting the transfers. and getting the right guys into his program.
So third down and 7 from the 45. Flags down, play blown dead.
False start. Offense from the 79. 5-yard penalty. Third down.
The left tackle, Justin Adekoya, fourth-year junior out of Ringgold, Georgia, whistled for the penalty. So now it's going to be third down and 12 from the 40.
We're seeing mistakes here on both sides. Both teams really trying to settle in. And for Eastern Kentucky, this is obviously a big crowd. It's a big stadium. Mm-hmm. It's a big opportunity. You really kind of got to not let that pressure get to you.
They play their home games in Roy Kidd Stadium there in Richmond, Kentucky, capacity 20,000.
A few more people here than that.
Let's see if we had movement up there, or whether that's NC State.
The right guard, Chance Edwards, got hit back.
Offside defense with contact. 5-yard penalty, third down.
B.J. Hill was among those. I think there was a couple of guys that jumped. But they get the 5 yards back, so now it's third down and 7 again. That is the fourth penalty on NC State after only one penalty and no offensive penalties last week in their opener against Troy. Coney out here to Lane. He can't hold on to it.
Now that's a throw that Coney should be able to make there. You got to give your running back an opportunity to catch the ball and move upfield. But again, we've seen the mistakes from both teams. Both teams really trying to settle in and figure it out. I mean, if you'd have said that 54 seconds left in the first quarter, there'd be no scores, I don't know that anyone would have thought that.
Third possession coming up empty for Eastern Kentucky. Rusak. Off the side of his foot. Very poor punt. Let's see where they spot this thing. The official line of scrimmage for the kick was the 45. They're still walking up the sideline. And they are going to finally stop at the 40-yard line. That's a 15-yard kick for Rusak, a guy that was booting at a 50 yards per kick average prior to that shank. On a day when the OVC's Jacksonville State nearly pulled off a big upset at number 6 Auburn before losing in overtime, Eastern Kentucky of the OVC scoreless with NC State here with 47 seconds to play in the first quarter. And Darius, in this first quarter, the story has been the Colonels' defense led by their head coach Dean Hood forcing a turnover, which was a big concern for NC State.
Yeah, and it's also been special teams as well. You know, you talk about a blocked field goal, you talked about the shank kick. It's a lot of things that are having an impact on this game.
Matt Canada, the OC for the Wolfpack, said they were very concerned about the turnovers. The Colonels led the nation in forced turnovers with 33 a year ago, and they were number 1 in the OVC in turnover margin. There's Samuels across the 50-yard line, and he's got a first down.
Yeah, and we saw this play work quite a bit against Troy last week for the Wolfpack. Motion sweep with Samuels.
They really like Jalen Samuels, the sophomore. Dave Doran told us he could play tailback and carry the ball 30 times. He could line him up as a wide receiver. Technically, he's a fullback and tight end in this NC State offense. Brissett, ball incomplete. Hines, the intended target, couldn't come up with it.
And that's another drop here. We've seen Hines with the drop. We saw Ramos earlier in the game with the drop. It never helps your quarterback, especially at times like this when you're trying to build that momentum and get something positive going. You see the numbers here, 53 yards today, 4-6.
98 yards of total offense for NC State here in the opening quarter. Only 10 for Eastern Kentucky, yet we're still scoreless. Days on the carry, stopped at the 45. 3-yard pickup from Matt Days on what may have been the final play of the first quarter.
Marcus,
And that'll bring the first 15 minutes to a close. One quarter in the book in Raleigh, North Carolina. And still scoreless. You're watching the ACC on ESPN. Start of the second quarter in Raleigh, NC State and Eastern Kentucky scoreless. 102 yards of offense over 11 minutes time of possession, Darius. But no score so far for the Wolfpack. What's been wrong with the offense?
Well, Matt, for NC State, it's really been them beating themselves. We've seen penalties, we've seen offsides, we've seen fumbles, drop passes. They're just hurting themselves.
Third down here to start the second quarter. Brissett stands in there, fires, that's complete, and a first down catch for Gavin Locklear.
But this is exactly what Coach Doran talked about, is not beating yourself. You can't put yourself in those situations where you allow a team like Eastern Kentucky to hang around.
Locklear, walk-on, former walk-on, awarded a scholarship in August, missed last season with a broken leg. So first and 10 for the Wolfpack from the Eastern Kentucky 34-yard line. Days scrambles forward, picks up about three on the play. Avery Pitt, the defensive tackle, in on that tackle for the Colonels. Days now up to eight carries, 41 yards.
Picking up right where he left off last week. This is a game like this, 0-0 earlier in the second quarter. It's all about, when are your playmakers going to step up and make a play? When will that guy change the scope for your team, and who is it going to be?
Second down. Nice block in the backfield by Days. Throw downfield and a nice catch, but unable to keep his feet in bounds, Braylon Cherry.
Going to set up a third down in medium here. As you mentioned the Days, I mean, this gets me excited from the running back position. A nice block out of there, but let's just see. Braylon Cherry here just a little bit out of bounds.
That's a nice catch, but he just couldn't get those feet down. Or a foot down, which is all that's needed. So third down and seven.
This play is under view.
Take another look at it here. Cherry, get that foot down.
Jerry Mosley is our replay technician tonight.
We're looking for 1 foot down. That's all that's needed. He's got to have control of the football first. It's tough from that angle.
I think that left foot hit down out of bounds.
Let's see.
Let's see.
And it's a catch.
Well,
yeah,
let's see.
In his hands.
But does he have possession?
Does he have possession? Yeah, that's always the question. It's got to be indisputable evidence to overturn this. Does he drag that left foot? That's close.
Yeah, well, he had his hands on the ball. He had both hands on the ball, and he had a foot down in bounds. But does he have possession?
Ball doesn't move from there either. That's a tough call.
And remember, the call on the field was incompletion.
Incomplete pass, yes.
Pat Garvey, our referee tonight. That's a tough call because the official's right there on top of it from where we sit. I thought incompletion.
Yeah.
But upon reviewing the replay, he did get both hands on the ball and a foot down in bounds.
Well, that's why the call on the field is always so critical in what they call. Because you got to have enough evidence to overturn that call. And that's the question here.
Okay, now here's what the officials are looking at right now.
Again, it's that right foot. Is it down when he gets both hands on the football? And does he have control?
He never bobbled it.
Never bobbled it at all, yeah.
It was just a matter of pulling the ball into his body.
After further review, the ruling on the field is completed pass. Ball will be placed at the 9.5 yard line. Game clock at 13:55. First down.
Well, that answers the question, Darius.
Yeah.
He had possession.
Had possession of it. The ball didn't move. He had both hands on the football. But that was a close call. Either way, good challenge, though, Coach Doran.
So first and goal to go with the ball at the 9.5. Best opportunity yet for the Wolfpack to score in this game.
Now, if you remember last week with NC State, this is where Samuels got involved, specifically on his three touchdown carries.
Cook, the tight end, in motion behind the line. Days gets the handoff, and Days down to the 5-yard line. That's a pickup of about 4 yards on the play. Big, strong run for a 5'9", 203 back who compares his style to Ray Rice.
Yeah, he's one of those guys who we always talk about his versatility, but the biggest thing is how he can break tackles at his size. It doesn't matter if you're a big defensive lineman or a linebacker. He creates a matchup issue for you, and it's just so hard to get this guy down.
One of only three players in the nation last season with at least 300 yards rushing, receiving, and in returns. You see, he's at 45 yards rushing so far tonight. Second down and goal. Brissett to the air. That's a touchdown. The tight end, Benson Brown, with the touchdown catch.
You'll see Brown on the outside here. Brissett just nice and easy, the flat route, wide open. He beats Montgomery, the cornerback, to the edge there. 6 points for NC State.
A week ago, Brown with his first career catch and touchdown. He gets another one here tonight for the senior graduate. Bambard with the PAT. 2 minutes and 6 seconds into the second quarter, NC State finally gets into the end zone. The touchdown catch by Benson Brown, and the Wolfpack take a 7-0 lead. NC State 7-0 lead on Eastern Kentucky. Matt Stewart along with former Notre Dame star running back Darius Walker. And Darius, Dean Hood told us going into their opener against Valpo, his big concern was his quarterback play. Well, after one quarter, your thoughts on what Benny Coney has done so far?
Well, it's been tough for him to get in a rhythm, because when you look at the time of possession right now, they've only had the ball a little under 5 minutes, and he's only thrown 4 pass attempts. Completed one of those, so he hasn't really had a chance to get into a rhythm. And offensively for Eastern Kentucky, it's now or never. You got to keep this game close, because otherwise NC State will put their foot on the gas.
They've run 9 plays and have 10 total yards. Absanon from a yard deep in the end zone. He had 182 yards of all-purpose yardage last week against Valpo, and this time does not make it back to the 20 as he gets stopped at about the 17-yard line. So Absanon, who's one of the most explosive players for the Colonels, can't get back to the 20.
Yeah, he had 182 all-purpose yards last week against Valparaiso. Had the interception return for the touchdown. He's the kickoff guy. He's also the punt returner as well. But NC State saw the same film we did, so they know number 27 is going to be coming.
So let's see if the Colonels can get anything started on offense. Coney, the transfer from the University of Cincinnati, hands off to Mobley, and first big carry from Mobley. He'll move the sticks as he rumbles out for a 10-plus yard gain.
The reality is for Eastern Kentucky on offense, they don't need home runs. They need methodical drives down the field. And one of the ways to do that is give it to the reigning offensive player of the year in the conference.
Hammer the ball with Mobley, who was a finalist for the Walter Payton Award. Ball on the ground. And Eastern Kentucky able to get on top of it.
You got to look at Coney here. Not looking at the snap. Hits him right in the face. Not paying attention. Trying to put that mouthpiece in.
Fortunately for Eastern Kentucky, Mobley was paying attention.
That could have been a disaster.
Second down and 13 from the 25. Coney being chased. He'll get rid of it and throws complete. Just does get back to the sticks right there. Catch made by Maiden, the tight end. And they're going to rule it incomplete.
Yeah, they waved it off. Looks like he did not control the ball all the way on the all the way down to the ground.
So third down and 13 from the 25. Eastern Kentucky has not been able to muster any kind of offense against the Wolfpack tonight. A Wolfpack team that played fairly well on defense with the exception of four plays last week in their 49-21 victory over Troy. Coney going across the field. That's a completion and a first down to Jeff Glover, who caught two touchdown passes from Coney last week.
That's a good third down play by Eastern Kentucky. And you got to give credit to Coney here. The offensive line gives him time. There's no blitz. Allows him just to funnel it in there to Glover.
So first and 10 for the Colonels from the 46. Coney being chased by Chubb, throws downfield. That's another completion. Flag comes out, and we'll check the call there.
And Beasley get involved there.
Yeah, it looks like the play is going to be erased.
Ineligible receiver downfield, number 33 on the offense. The player was covered by a wide receiver, therefore making him illegal to go downfield. First down.
That was Beasley who's saying, I'm a slot back. Why can't I be downfield?
That's a tough one there. We'll have to take another look at it if we can. Young Beasley.
Yeah, a five-yard penalty, and it erases what was a first down completion. And the ball on the other side of the 50.
But the first down does still stand, it looks like.
Yeah, so it's first and 15 now. Coney goes to Beasley. Beasley can't get a handle on it.
We've seen Coney miss two of those passes. Both of them happen to be to Beasley. But he's having some issues with his short pass to his left side. So throwing across his body for short passes, those screen passes to the wide receiver, he's having issues so far here today.
Coney, the full-time starter this season after splitting time with Jared McClain
really
last
on
year.
The field. It's a backward pass. Previous pass was unreal.
Wow, so that's going to be a three-yard loss. They're going to actually rule that a rush and not a pass. And I believe they'll take a look at this one, too.
Horrible! We talked about Coney here. Trying to see if it's a lateral here, but we talked a lot about Coney, the transfer from Cincinnati. You know, he split time last year as the starting quarterback. And they were worried about QB play coming in. Now, again, across his body, he's got to be able to make this throw.
Yeah, that's
we're trying to see if it's behind. Doesn't look like it from our vantage point, but.
Well, I mean, it looked like Coney was standing at the 35, and it hit Beasley's hands around the 37, so that's 2 yards forward. I don't know that it certainly didn't even look like on the replay that it was even close to being a lateral. But for some reason, the officials felt the need to get on the headset there and check it out. Didn't look close.
Coney's got to be able to make that throw, though. That's an easy touch pass.
And you're right, when he took over, when he came in last year from the University of Cincinnati, you know, they felt, you know, they said that perception was not the same as reality. He had not played for a couple of years
while,
at Cincinnati. They thought that he would be a ready-made quarterback and a guy to step right in and be the starter, and he was not that. And they claim now that they really did him a disservice by not really allowing him time to develop and expecting more out of him than he could have given them initially.
Yeah, you know, sometimes you get thrown into the fire, and that's exactly what happened with Beanie. Just got thrust into the mix, and he hadn't played in a few years, so there was a lot of rust that he was kicking off last year. And you can see some of the issues that he's continuing to have.
Well, Pat Garvey continues to take a look at this thing. Confounds me a little bit because it didn't look like it was close.
After review, ruling on the field is confirmed. Backward pass, third down.
Well, what do I know?
Again, I told you. You just...
I don't know how that, because it looked to me like Coney released the pass at the 35 and it hit Beasley's hands at the 37, but maybe I was looking at something else. So they lose 3 yards on that play, and now it's second down and 18.
This makes it really hard for offensive coordinator Dane Dameron to really figure out what to do. You're looking at that call sheet and it's second and 18. There's not a whole lot of plays that you have in your playbook for that.
Just get a little bit back.
Just a small change.
Try to make third down a little manageable.
Really having a stoppage of play right now.
Delay game.
Offense.
Wow.
5 yard penalty. Second down.
Again, Eastern Kentucky needs to hit the reboot button.
Yeah, this is all on the quarterback here.
All right, let's take another look at this play. Now, watch Coney, the quarterback.
Okay, the line of scrimmage is here at the 39.
Yeah, but he releases the ball at the 35, and it hit Beasley's hands at the 37. Am I seeing something else? Or are they seeing something else? It looked like it was a 2 yard forward pass, but Beasley, or rather Coney, now running, and Coney slides under at the 39 yard line rather than take the big hit. And it's going to be fourth down or third down now. Third down now and long.
Yeah, completely out of sync is really what I see right now from Eastern Kentucky and their offense. Just there's delay of games. Guys don't look like they know where they're going. They're not in sync right now. You're seeing the effects of that.
Colonels are 1 for 4 on their third downs. Coney will step out of bounds at the 43-yard line. Never got back to the original line of scrimmage. And once again, Rusak will have to come out and punt.
Yeah, this was a tough offensive series here for Eastern Kentucky. I mean, we saw a number of different things go wrong in an offense that desperately needs to get some momentum.
Which brings up an interesting question. Kyle Romano started for them last week against Valpo when Coney could not play or start because of his allergic reaction. And Romano's a guy that they're very high on. Might we see a change in quarterback before the night is over if Coney and this offense can't get things in sync?
You know, I wouldn't put it past him, especially with halftime coming up. That's when you can make those kind of adjustments, typically at the quarterback.
The sideline, they're still running up the sideline. They finally stop at the 26-yard line. So not 15-yarder on his last kick. And NC State will have the ball when we get back. A full 57,600 here at Carter-Finley Stadium tonight in Raleigh as NC State playing their second home game of the season and leading Eastern Kentucky of the OVC 7-0, 5 minutes and 12 seconds into the second quarter. We do have some heavier clouds lurking off into the distance. We're hopeful that the rain will hold off until the completion of this game. So first and 10 for the Wolfpack from the 25. Brissett with the pump fake. And looking deeper down the field and complete at the 44-yard line, and it's Ramos again.
Ramos is really starting to turn on here, but you mentioned the pump fake. This is a double move on the outside by Ramos here. It's a double move and then a comeback. And boy, does Brissett hit him right as he turns around. That is a quarterback and a wide receiver being on the same page if I've ever seen one.
Ramos having himself quite a ball game. 4 catches now for 64 yards. After 3 catches for 45 yards last week, and it's a first and 10 from the 44. Days took a whack as he cut back into the hole. Picked up a couple of yards on the play. like Logan Ose on the tackle.
Back up corner.
Brings up a second down and six. Day's 10 carries for 49 yards so far in here the first half. Brissett to Ramos again. Man, he has become a first down machine tonight. First down at the 45.
It is all about creating matchups on offense. And right now, they don't have anyone for Eastern Kentucky that can cover Jermichael Ramos right now.
Back
he
in his freshman
field.
Yeah, back in his freshman season, Darius, 9 of his 24 catches came on third or fourth down, and he was the co-recipient of the Phillip Rivers Award, which goes to the program's top freshman.
Excellent freshman campaign. That's why they're so excited to see what he's doing so far this year.
Yeah, it looks like his junior campaign might be even better as Daves dances for 5 yards down to the 40.
That's always exciting to see when you see a guy who, like Ramos, who had an excellent freshman campaign and then his second year he disappeared some. And as you get a shot here, Dorian not afraid to play the young players, 51 freshmen.
Yeah, that 11 seniors makes up only 10% of their roster. Second smallest senior class in the ACC behind Wake Forest and the sixth smallest in the nation.
It's all about getting the right guys in your program. And NC State really starting to turn the corner, and that's because they're getting that talent in. You see those young players playing early. Well, you can't do that if those guys aren't winning those responsibilities and winning those jobs.
Last year improved to 8-5 after going 3-9 in Dave Doran's first season. Finished the season on a 3-game winning streak, which is now 4, including their victory over Troy to start this season. And they've won 5 of their last 6. Days in motion to the top. And Brissett on a design run. First down run for Brissett.
You very rarely see NC State do this, these called runs, but they like this matchup on the weak side. Brissett, almost a late hit there, going low, out of bounds.
And he rushed for 529 yards last year, which was a program quarterback rushing record. And Dave Doran told us that 75% of those runs were scrambles.
Yeah, he's taking off on his own because he sees open field.
First and 10 from the 24. Days again on the carry. Not much doing that time as Bryce Krebs, the defensive tackle, made the tackle.
You love to see Brissett and what he's done this offseason. The coaches call him a man on a mission. The time that he spent in the film room, the work that he's done on preparing for this season. Starting to see it pay off the last few weeks. A shot of his numbers here. 9 yards rushing, 116 yards pass. Still only 2 incompletions.
Yeah, he has only 4 incompletions in his first 6 quarters of play this season. That's pretty darn good.
I don't know if you can get much more accurate than that.
Time for Brissett. He was looking for the tight end Greenwich there at the goal line.
Tight end here, David Greenwich, number 86. Set. Nice pocket. Able to deliver a good ball. It's a little bit of an overthrow. You'd like to see him possibly throw that to the outside shoulder. Allow the tight end to run underneath it. But again, only his 3rd incompletion of the game.
3rd down and 9 coming up. Wolfpack 4-5 on their 3rd downs tonight. It's Locklear in motion. Blitz coming from deep. Brissett avoids it. Complete to Samuels. That's a first down to the 11-yard line. Absenon makes the tackle, but there's Samuels again coming up with a big play when they needed it most.
Again, he was our impact player. And you see Samuels, just the versatility there. The fact that they hand this guy the ball and also split him out at wide receiver is just incredible. But Brissett extending the play with his legs and still being able to deliver a pass on the move.
3rd touch of the night for Samuels, his 3rd catch, and he also has a rush.
first charge timeout, Eastern Kentucky.
So Colonels take a breath here with 5:17 to play in the half. Wolfpack, Abbott, first and 10 at the 12 when we get back. 7-0 NC State. Wolfpack on the verge, perhaps another touchdown. And Darius, what's happened to Noah Spence here in the second quarter?
Well, it's been a combination of Joe Tooney getting his stuff together and then the play calling so far that's going away from him. But we've seen him disappear a little bit in this game. He started off hot in the first quarter. Again, this guy a few years ago was first team all Big Ten. So he's an NFL type talent. You want to see him get more involved in this game.
Wolfpack offensive line starting to push the Colonels around. Samuels around in. Touchdown! Jalen Samuels finds the end zone again for the fourth time this season. And the Wolfpack have a 13-0 lead.
I tell you, the motion sweep is really the play call right now that is working so well for the Wolfpack. You see Samuels here almost untouched. As Kobe Grace takes an inside angle there at corner. But Samuels, again, having that impact. He doesn't touch the ball a lot. They don't hand it to him a lot, but when they do, he scores touchdowns.
I love his efficiency rating. Bampard with the PAT and a 14-0 lead for the Wolfpack.
Again, this is all predicated off of Kobe Grace, number 38, on the edge. He's just going to take the wrong angle. Now Samuels to take it to the house. 14-0. It's 16.
Some rain off on the horizon to the northwest of Carter-Finley Stadium. Right now, NC State raining on Eastern Kentucky's parade. 14-0. With 5 minutes to play here in the first half, after a slow start to this ballgame, a scoreless first quarter for the Wolfpack, they've turned things up a notch here in the second quarter. Non-returnable. Ball will come out to the 25, and now we'll see if the Colonels can get something going on offense. They just have not been able to get anything going yet.
Yeah, you know, you talked about the start at the beginning of this game. It just has continued for the Colonels on offense, unable to really get any kind of life. And the reason that is because they've been shooting themselves in the foot some with some offsides penalties that really stop momentum and stop drives. So they got to get it together. And again, they don't need a touchdown right now. They just need a nice methodical drive, get down there and get some points on the board.
And outside of a 21-yard pass to Jeff Glover, they really haven't been able to get downfield at all. Coney going up top, battled for the ball out there. That's Glover, the target again. And the ball is going to be caught by Glover. Again, they go Glover's way, and again, it pays off.
He is in a battle on this play with Niles Clark, the corner number 6. But watch these two. A little bit of a shove there, some jersey grabbing. Excellent play, though, by Jeff Glover coming down with the football.
Glover, a 43-catch season a year ago as Mobley crashes through the line, picks up a first down, but a flag down.
Again, this is what's been happening to Eastern Kentucky. Get some momentum going, and then there's a flag or some kind of penalty that sets them back. So hopefully this isn't on them. But if it is, it's just been the same recipe that they've had thus far.
Personal foul, face mask, defense number 6, 15-yard penalty. What about a first down?
We're going to call Niles Clark here again. He was the guy who was battling with Glover on that play.
That was the previous play. This might have been maybe some retaliation going on.
A little bit of retaliation there, yeah. A little frustration maybe from number 6. But you see Mobley here finally starting to get started. Excellent run. You really want to get this guy going if you're Eastern Kentucky.
So a catch by Glover and then a penalty on Niles gives Eastern Kentucky a first and 10 at the NC State 27-yard line.
Second charge timeout, Eastern Kentucky.
Talk about it here. Obviously a pivotal moment in
so
the game right
30
now.
Second timeout.
So while they take the timeout, ball at the 27, what have they been able to do? They've got the big pass to Glover. Glover's kind of been their guy to go to get some big, albeit just two big plays.
Sure.
What do you do here on a first and 10 from the 27 with your best field position of the night?
Well, again, it's all about trying to get it in chunks. You don't have to score a touchdown here. You just need a few yards. And so we've been waiting to see DeShawn Mobley and what he's going to be able to do. I suspect that they'll continue to try to get him involved. But for the quarterback and Beanie Coney, you got to do some vertical passes for him. We've seen what Glover's doing. Expect him to be targeted heavily right now as you get in the red zone.
Well, let's see what they do coming out of the timeout. They have one timeout remaining in the half, trailing by a couple of touchdowns here, but a touchdown obviously would go a long way to getting them back in the ballgame in this situation. First and 10. Coney, the keeper. And Coney gets dropped at the 25-yard line by Chubb, just a couple of yards on the play.
NC State dialed up a blitz there with Mike linebacker Fernandez. Unable to get there. That's a good job by Coney, making something out of nothing there for a few yards.
Second down and 8. Nothing doing.
Scott Daniel there on the run, number 12. See them trying to take a play out of NC State's offense with Samuels, that motion sweep here. See 12 come right across your face there. This is an excellent job by the Wolfpack, stringing the ball out and making the play.
Arius Moore, the linebacker, making the tackle, and now the Colonels face a third down and 11. Where's Glover? When they've needed a big play, it's been Coney to Glover. And they go to Glover, and he's got the first down inside the 10-yard line. It's worked twice, and now it's worked three times.
Again, this is this one-on-one battle with Niles Clark, and the difference here is you got to see Glover. This is an excellent pass by Coney come across the middle, but no help from the safety there for Clark. And this one-on-one matchup right now is key.
Darius, you keep doing it until they stop it, right?
Don't know why you would change it. It's getting you all the way down here now.
First and goal to go from the 8. Coney fires, and that ball is out. That's going to be an incompletion.
Not sure why that's still in the playbook. I mean, the two times that it
ruling
is
on the field is an incomplete pass.
Well, they were trying to get the ball to Michael Scott. It was going to be a screen. Scott was the intended target, and Joel Brown was supposed to be the blocker on the play, but Brown got blocked right back into the pass.
These screen passes have not worked today. You'd like to think that they will throw that out of the playbook, because it has put them in dangerous situations that are just unnecessary right now. On second down and goal,
I say go to Glover. Coney, blitz is coming, and he got rid of it just in time. An incompletion to Mobley. And now it's going to be third down and goal from the 8.
NC State is dialing up that blitz. There's pressure here. No one accounts for the backer coming right up the middle there, Arius Moore, number 58. Line's supposed to slide to him or something. Somebody missed their assignment there, so they're going to get an earful. Coach on the sideline.
By the way, Glover's up top, out of your picture, top of the screen. They look to. And broken up. Flag comes out, however. Michael Stevens broke it up, but a flag out in the end zone.
Question is, he's got to turn around and look for the ball. Stevens has got to turn around and see it.
Pass interference, defense number 20. Foul third in the end zone. If a by rule, the ball is against the 2-yard line.
Watch Glover here. Pressure, he just lays it up, and Stevens has to turn around to see it. He does look. His body's there. That's a tough call.
Yeah, I thought Stevens had good defense.
He turns around and takes a look. He does see the ball, gets his hand up in the air.
Wow.
I mean, the corner has an opportunity to go for the ball as well. That's a tough call.
I've seen a lot more not call.
Yeah. I've definitely seen them a lot worse. Jeez.
First and goal from the 2 now following the penalty. Mobley. does not get in.
Well, we've seen two penalties that have really kept Eastern Kentucky in this. You just saw the pass interference, but then also remember a few plays back, the face mask on the pass as well. So penalties definitely keeping Eastern in it.
Yeah, North Carolina State has committed six penalties for 51 yards. Second and goal from just outside the one. Lane on the run, can't get there. Run down by Hakeem Jones, the safety. Man, Jones like a bolt of lightning. Cut him down before he could turn the corner.
He comes in there and almost clotheslines Adam Lane here. Watch lane number five come across and number one just come in and completely just one man band, just body slam him almost. You love to see that out of your safety. That's a big safety too at 6'2", 200 pounds.
Great closing speed, Hakeem Jones, and now third and goal from the four.
Where's Jeff Glover? That's always the question. Where's number 18?
He's down here on the bottom of your screen. There he is, number 18. Holding up his hands.
Timeout. 30-second timeout.
So Eastern Kentucky burns their final timeout. I know it sounds almost funny to keep saying this.
Eastern sets the game clock to 1 minute and 31 seconds.
But every time they've gone to Jeff Glover, something good has happened.
It has worked out.
So my question is, you know, why not go to Jeff Glover in this situation?
Again, he is having an excellent game, and it has worked out. But you also got to understand they have the reigning offensive player of the year in the conference, Deshaun Mobley, so I wouldn't be surprised if they hand it off to number seven as well.
Well, Glover, the senior out of Atlanta, gives them a big presence down there in the red zone with a 6'5", 215-pound frame.
And again, he's probably going to be going against, if they put him in the slot, he'll be going against either Hakeem Jones or Josh Jones, one of those safeties. So the height advantage,
I believe
he's
going
to win that.
I believe that's Dre Wright who's matched up across from him right now, who had the big hit against Troy last week. Third and goal from the four. Coney going to take a loss back at the 9-yard line.
Credit NC State, but also the play call there for Eastern after a timeout. Like they tried to run a read
option. Second charge timeout, North Carolina State. 30-second timeout.
But now the question becomes, you know, when's the last time you got in the red zone this deep if you're Eastern Kentucky? That hasn't happened much. Do you take and the field goal or the points, or do you go after trying to get it? And you see this last play here. Not really sure what the mindset was in terms of that play call, because conventional wisdom would say you either go to the guy who got you down there, Jeff Glover, or hand the ball to your reigning offensive player of the year.
Well, that was the senior defensive end, Mike Rose, who defensive coordinator Dave Huxtable read the riot act after his performance against Troy. He said, look, dude, you did not play like a senior. You got to play better than that. And Mike Rose comes up with probably the biggest defensive play of this game so far for the Wolfpack.
Yeah, most certainly. You know, Mike Rose, they've been looking at him more. They want more out of him to get his numbers there, 6'4", 238 pounds.
Well, that certainly was a big-time play right there. And on fourth and goal,
third and final charge timeout, Eastern Kentucky.
Eastern is going to talk about this.
30-second timeout.
For good reason. You talk about fourth down. Again, you got to try to take advantage of the opportunities that you get in the red zone. You're down 14 points. I mean,
well, how about that?
Conventional wisdom says kick the field goal, but I don't. Yeah.
They broke the huddle and ran to the line. Of course, NC State thinking probably field goal in this situation. But they throw him a curveball. But NC State also was kind of anticipating, hey, they're going to go for it right here. And so fourth and now nine, let's see, do they try that again or they bring the field goal kicker out?
Looks like they're going to try to go for it. And, I mean, you got to play to win the game here. I understand the call. And, hey, it's always a good one when it works out right.
Well, you got nothing to lose. You're the FCS team playing
most certainly
in the ACC's backyard, and you're down a couple of touchdowns. Been this close all night. Fourth and goal from the nine. Coney time, going up top, jump ball incomplete, looking for Joel Brown. And the ball will go over on downs as the Wolfpack come up with the big stop. And it was Mike Rose's quarterback sack on third down that really set it all up.
Yeah, Rose definitely set the tone here to put him in a tough fourth down situation. But again, the play calling there on the goal line, you know, you come out of a timeout and they want to throw the fade route. I mean, you would think that they get a little more creative than that, but as it stands, it goes over on downs. NC State with the stop. So now, you know, if you definitely should have kicked it.
Absolutely. No question.
Always know after the fact. You always know.
Yeah, that's the life of a coach, you know. Everybody knows the right answer after the play has been run. The only problem with the head coach is you got to make the call before the play is run. Now, Eastern Kentucky needs to be careful here. I would not be surprised if NC State tried to sneak a big one on them right here, try to get long on them once before the end of the half. Troy did that to them last week.
They most certainly did. Nothing wrong with taking a shot right now.
Instead, they hand the ball off to Days. Not much doing. No threat of Eastern Kentucky being able to stop the clock since they've burned all their timeouts.
14-0 is good if you're NC State.
They're not going to take a shot. They're going to take a walk to the locker room.
They're okay with being up 14 going into the third quarter.
So the first 30 minutes in the books here at Carter-Finley Stadium. And NC State wary of perhaps an OVC upset like Auburn nearly had done to them today by Jacksonville State.
The end of the half.
Well, the Wolfpack take a 14-0 lead to the locker room. Welcome back to the Capital One Halftime Report from Carter-Finley Stadium in Raleigh, North Carolina, where the NC State Wolfpack lead Eastern Kentucky 14-0. Matt Stewart along with Darius Walker. Let's take a look at all the other action around the Atlantic Coast Conference this weekend. Games that are currently in progress, starting with the final today. Your alma mater, number 9, Notre Dame, of a tough battle, but beat Virginia 34-27.
Yeah, we've seen Virginia play two solid games the last 2 weeks, but Notre Dame able to edge them out.
Virginia Tech an easy winner over the Furman Paladins 42-3. And then games here in the triangle, Duke leading NC Central 24-0 at halftime. North Carolina a 36-0 lead on North Carolina A&T at the half. And also at the half, Pitt on the road leading Akron 10-7. Now these are the finals, starting with Friday night's contest. Miami a 24-point winner over Florida Atlantic. Florida State had a bit of a struggle today. Things were not so easy for Jimbo Fisher's team. The 11th-ranked Seminoles did pull away late, though, and beat South Florida 34-14. Houston hands Louisville their second loss of the season, so Bobby Petrino's team starts 0-2 as the Cougars beat the Cardinals 34-31. Clemson, no problem with App State, 41-10. Syracuse, a winner over Wake Forest in conference action. Boston College clobbered Howard, and Georgia Tech, another big winner as the Yellow Jackets thump Tulane. Halftime here in Raleigh, North Carolina, with the Wolfpack on top by a couple of touchdowns. We'll take a look at the first half highlights when we get back. You're watching the Capital One Halftime Report from Raleigh, North Carolina, where NC State holds a 14-0 lead on Eastern Kentucky. Matt Stewart joined by former Notre Dame star running back Darius Walker. Your thoughts on that first half? For that first quarter, it looked like Eastern Kentucky took advantage of an NC State team that was a little sluggish. Second quarter, though, belonged to the Wolfpack.
Yeah, you know, you talk about week one penalties and issues that teams have. We didn't see that at NC State a week ago against Troy, but you see that creeping in tonight. They got 6 penalties. They only had 1 a week ago. That's been the big story as to why this game is close. It's because of those penalties.
They finally got things clicking in that second quarter after a scoreless first quarter. Big catch. They had to go to the replay to confirm by Braylon Cherry, set up their first touchdown.
Yeah, and they just looked good from time to time as the time went on. And you see here,
Brissett has been excellent. You talk about the completions from a week ago and how well this guy has played. He just continues to shine as the quarterback for the Wolfpack.
But not just the completions, but also a big pickup there with his legs. And then the sweep to Jalen Samuels for their second touchdown.
Yeah, you know, he was our impact player. We talked a lot about that motion sweep, and it just continues to work for the Wolfpack here. And you can't talk about them offensively without mentioning Matt Days. He has been electric. He's running the football really well, and he's a versatile player.
And Eastern Kentucky did force NC State into their first turnover of the season and had it first and goal at the 2-yard line on their final possession. Came up empty, and the yardage story totally in NC State's favor, 227-92.
Yeah, I mean, you can see the difference in terms of rush yards there, but for crap, man, my guys.
For Eastern Kentucky, they came up empty on their final possession.
Yeah, so they here's most certainly
the story. Yeah, so what, as we look ahead to the second half, what does NC State have to do to put this thing away and avoid what happened with Auburn today, where they went down to the final minutes and into overtime to win that ball game?
Well, again, it's about those missed opportunities. And for NC State, it's about not shooting yourself in the foot. We talked about the penalties there and the difference between last week and this week. So they've had those issues. If they can just play their own football, they'll be good to go. But right now, they're up 2 scores.
It's halftime here in Raleigh, North Carolina. The Wolfpack with a 2-touchdown lead on the Colonels. You're watching the ACC on ESPN as we welcome you back to Carter-Finley Stadium in Raleigh, North Carolina. The host NC State Wolfpack with a 14-0 lead on Eastern Kentucky. And Darius, in the last segment we asked, what did NC State have to do to put this game away and avoid what happened to Auburn earlier today?
Right.
Well, the next question is, what does Eastern Kentucky have to do what Jacksonville State did to get this thing late?
Yeah, they really want to try to keep this game close, but it's all going to come down to that impact player we talked about in Deshaun Mobley and what he's been able to do. When you look at the carries that he's had this game, he's only carried the ball 5 times. Again, we're talking about the reigning offensive player of the year in the conference, so they got to figure out a way to get number 7 the ball.
Only 21 yards rushing for Eastern Kentucky tonight. On an offense with 8 returning starters and 4 starters on that offensive line. But then again, going up against NC State,
yeah,
you know, a team that they're supposed to lose to. And, I mean, let's face it, this is a money game for Eastern Kentucky. Their job is to come in and upset the apple cart.
Yeah, most certainly.
And had they been able to score on that last possession, would have been a little bit different story here as we start this third quarter. But even as it is, they're only down 2 touchdowns.
They're still only down 2 touchdowns. It's still a close game. The game is not over by any means. But, yeah, for Eastern Kentucky, you talk about the missed opportunities. They blocked the field goal early in the game. You mentioned that they got down to the 2-yard line, had 4 tries at it, and couldn't punch it in. So it's Eastern Kentucky really taking advantage of those opportunities. But the game is still close right now. We mentioned it at halftime. NC State has not played like they did last week. They've had a lot of mistakes. They've had some issues. Luckily, they've been able to overcome it so far, but they're only up 2 scores as it stands.
Dave Doran, who had great success at Northern Illinois before taking over the NC State Wolfpack program, 12-14 now in the start of his third season. Phenomenal 23-4 record at Northern Illinois.
Yeah, he had the second most wins over that time period behind Nick Saban. So that just goes to show you a guy in rare company but knows how to get the job done at a high level.
Became the first coach ever to lead a MAC team to a BCS bowl appearance as Northern Illinois played in the 2012 Orange Bowl. And Hines will come up and take the kick at the 9-yard line. And Hines up to the 30-yard line before being brought down by Jordan Whitfield. And that's where the Wolfpack will start on offense for the first time here in the third quarter.
Now, Brissett, we talked about him at the top. And at halftime, I mean, this guy is really one who is playing really well right now. Look at his numbers, 10 of 13, 127 yards passing right now. Again, those three completions, three incompletions. He's only got three tonight. He only had two last week, so a very accurate passer.
On the watch list for the Manning, Unitas, and Maxwell Awards, that's Hines on the carry after returning the kickoff, and Hines picks up about 3 yards on the play.
This is normally a play where they use Jalen Samuels, number 28. We saw him score the touchdown earlier. But this time they let the freshman take it on that motion sweep. They're finding a lot of success over that over the last 2 weeks. So Samuels coming back in the game here.
They gave Hines 4 yards on the play. So second down and six from the 34 and a half. Ramos again cuts back to find some room. And actually, that's Samuels, pardon me. 28, Samuels on the catch and the run. And Samuels continues to turn heads.
Continuing to have an impact on this game. And this is just a playmaker getting out in space and making it happen. Nice short slip pass here to Samuels at wide receiver, and he's just making people miss again. You give the ball to your playmakers to do something with it. And boy, putting on a clinic right now.
32-yard pickup for Jalen Samuels. And again, the Wolfpack showing off his versatility. You line him up at a wide receiver position and watch what he can do as Bryce Krebs, the defensive tackle, is having to be helped off the field.
Hate to see guys go down specifically for Eastern. We mentioned the depth earlier. Many FCS programs, you don't have a bunch of guys that play at a high level, just nature of it, so hopefully he can get back out there.
Brissett, complete. That is Ramos that time, down to the 23, as Ramos makes his sixth catch of the night.
You got to look at Eastern Kentucky here playing defense. I mean, they're playing so far off the wide receivers. That time, Dino Montgomery was probably about 10 yards back from Ramos, so they're opening up the door there for those dump passes.
Second down and one. Ramos now six catches for 80 yards tonight. Days gets the handoff. A cutback. It's a sprint to the pylon. Touchdown, Matthew Days.
I mean, you really get a sense that they went in at halftime and had a conversation and said, hey, we are Wolfpack. We know what we're doing. Let's go out and play our game. We've been calling Days' name all night. This time he takes it to pay dirt.
25-yard touchdown run to cap a four-play, 70-yard drive in the opening 1 minute and 35 seconds. Bambard with the PAT in NC State. Comes out and makes an emphatic statement to start this third quarter that they want to finish this thing off in a hurry.
They most certainly do. That jump cut, you cannot coach it. Days takes it to the house. NC State up 21-0.
NC State making a statement here to start this third quarter with a four-play, 70-yard drive capped on the 25-yard run by Matt Days. Pack in Black Knight here in Raleigh, North Carolina. The Wolfpack wearing their all-black uniforms this evening. Jumped out to a 3-touchdown lead on the visitors from the Ohio Valley Conference. Again, a non-returnable kick. So when you've got a dynamic kick returner like Absena, you take him out of the mix by just kicking it over his head.
You most certainly do, but one guy you can't take out of the mix is Matthew Days. As we get another look at the score here, takes it to the house from 25, and I think that the silver lining always that you got to understand is this guy is the second string running back.
Yep.
He's number two. He's not the number one guy, so Matthew Days really making a name for himself and continuing to show why his teammates voted him the offensive player of the year last year.
That number one guy, Shadrack Thornton, serving the second game of his two-game suspension for a violation of department rules reported by ESPN, a failed drug test. big hit out there after the catch by Beasley. Wow. Burris, the corner, knocked him flat. Maybe knocked the air out of him, too.
He knocked a little bit of that wind out. Again, he was in a bad position because he couldn't see the defender coming, so he almost couldn't really brace or protect himself there. Big hit by Burris.
Second down and two. High snap. Coney gets a piece of it and gets down in a hurry. And that's kind of been the story for Eastern Kentucky. When you do something good, they'll follow it up with a disastrous play that sets them back. And now their second down and two has become a third down and eight.
Yeah, they keep shooting themselves in the foot. One thing that you can't do for an offense, and you're losing that momentum. But I think the story really is Benny Coney. He has not had the type of game and the production that they would like to see out of him. I mean, 2 of 7 out of third down conversions. That's why you're down 21-0 right there.
Coney with pressure, throws, had to get rid of it in a hurry. He was about to get waylaid, and he did, but he did get rid of the ball. Now it's fourth down in a punting situation. I mean, it's hard to pin that one on Coney, man. He just had to get rid of that thing.
He most certainly did, but it looked like it was a bit of a miscommunication between he and the wide receiver here. Nowhere close, but he did just have to get rid of the football. You'd like to have your quarterback have more time, but we talked about this a little bit before halftime. When do you see Kyle Romano come in at the quarterback position, since Coney has been sort of stale and hasn't been able to get it done to that effect?
That was the sophomore Justin Jones who was breathing down his neck. Rusak on the punt, and he shanks it this time again. That's his second shank tonight. It's going to bounce and roll out of bounds at the 40-yard line. Now a wobbly kick. That ends up going 33 yards.
And again, that just kind of goes back to the story of what it's been for Eastern Kentucky. They haven't been able to get anything offensively. And then their kicking game, specifically when they punt the ball, that about two or three different times where we got shanked footballs. And again, that's just a mental error. That's an internal error. It's not anything that NC State is necessarily doing to affect that. You're just hurting yourself.
So the Pack back on offense, first and 10 from their 41, and a timeout called by Eastern Kentucky.
First charge timeout, Eastern Kentucky.
Again, slightly shocked that they called this so early.
So Dean Hood calls his guys over. They'll try to regroup, down three touchdowns here, 3 minutes in to the third quarter. Tough night for number four, Benny Coney. 5 of 13 for 79 yards and minus 7 yards rushing. When you factor in the sacks, that was the backup quarterback, number 9, Kyle Romano, sitting off to his right. As the Wolfpack, with their second possession of this second half, start from their own 41-yard line, first and 10. Days, no running room that time. Absanon made the tackle.
For NC State, it's about stepping on the gas right now. I mean, a touchdown will all but make this game fairly out of reach for Eastern Kentucky team that hasn't been able to get on the board yet. So you can be for sure that Dave Doran is really going to try to push to get some points on the board here. Make this game out of reach.
Yeah. And that, again, magnifies how big that stop was for NC State at the end of the first half, because they got the ball at the start of the third quarter and turned it into a very quick touchdown. So what would have been a 14-7 game very
exactly.
quickly became a 21-0
game. 21-0 game, yeah. And that's the thing, missed opportunities. You can't miss those opportunities for Eastern Kentucky. And that's why, you know, we talk about the quarterback situation that they have there. You wonder if they'll make a change, if they're even considering that. Because as of now, you know, their starter hasn't done. And that was the big worry, if you remember when we talked with Dean Hood about their offense, was the quarterback play. That was his worry coming into this season.
NC State 5 of 6 on their third downs. This is a third and 10. That's Samuels again. And look at Samuels going to come up short of the first down, however. Needed 10, got 8. Stopped at the 49.
Boy, is he dangerous in space.
He doesn't look like a fullback to me.
he's
got some moves. Usually fullbacks are bulldozers.
Yeah. You see big guys that don't have that agility that Samuels definitely does. You definitely wouldn't split a fullback out at slot receiver and throw him the football. So he's a guy that has that versatility.
He's got the body build of a 5'11", 236 fullback, but he doesn't have the shake and bake of a fullback. He has the shake and bake that a fullback typically doesn't have. Cole with the punt. Absanon makes the fair catch at the 18-yard line, and so that's where the Colonels will go back on offense. Second time in this third quarter.
Desperately need to try to get something going here. Again, the game, it's 21-0, but it's not over, if you will. They can get back in this. They just need to put together a drive and finally score some points.
Only 94 yards of total offense for Eastern Kentucky here tonight in the first 35 minutes of this game. Mobley has found the running room hard to come by tonight. But he picks up about five on that play right there.
And it gets even harder, you know, when you have such a dominant running back in Deshaun Mobley. It gets harder to use him when you're down 21-0. You know, now's the time where Eastern Kentucky is going to have to press a little bit and try to start throwing the ball, get some vertical routes going on offense.
Second down and four. Coney looking for Glover. Great coverage right there. Stevens right on top of Glover. Didn't give him any breathing room, and it's going to be third down.
Again, the offense just seems to not have a lot of passion right now. They're not fired up. You don't see the fire in the guy's eyes. You get a look at Coney's numbers, 5 of 14. It's not what you expect from your starting quarterback. So he has certainly struggled tonight.
Third down and four. Colonels 2 of 8 on their third downs. Heavy rush. Coney scrambling for his life, just has to get rid of it. Again, heavy, hard pressure coming. That was Chubb who got Coney on the ground, and it's going to be fourth down.
You got to give yourself an opportunity to win there. Third down and short. You would think that they would try to do something to get that first down. Again, you can press, but you don't have to score touchdowns immediately right now. You need to get a drive and some momentum going so you can have some positivity for your offense. Confidence definitely lacking for Eastern Kentucky offensively.
Rusak standing at his 10-yard line to kick. More like it for him as Cherry retreats all the way back to the 20-yard line to get it. And Braylon Cherry with a nice return across the 40. 55-yard kick. Jalen Samuels, look at his night tonight. Two carries, 24 yards, but he's also got four catches for 59 yards, six touches for 83 yards.
It's all about the all-purposeness of this guy as a player. You see him catching the ball at wide receiver here and just making things happen. He's really the playmaker of this team. They like to feed him the rock any way that they can. Boy, has he had some success tonight.
He gets it on the sweep. Not anywhere to go with it that time as he steps out of bounds at the 44-yard line. One of the few times tonight that Samuels has been held in check.
Yeah, most certainly. We have seen him run wild tonight. Plenty of opportunities.
It's interesting because you look at this NC State team and, you know, in the first couple of weeks of the season, it's the weapons that maybe you didn't expect. They have such a big role that have had a bigger role. Samuels and Days.
Yeah.
Part of that because Thornton has been out with a suspension. But Ramos has the wide receiver position. Incomplete as they tried the ball to Hines. He couldn't hold on to it.
Yeah, freshman had a drop there. But you're right. This offense is so balanced in what they can do. And again, they don't have their number one rusher from a year ago. They hadn't had him the last 2 weeks. So they can only get better.
Yeah. Thornton will be back next week. He is the top returning career rusher in the ACC now that James Conner has gone down with his knee injury at Pitt. So Thornton rushed for 907 yards last year. He's now the top career rusher in the conference. Or the one that is available.
Yeah.
Connor's still ahead of him, but Connor can't play this year. He's hurt his knee.
So to think that this offense can only get better, that's got to be exciting news for Dave Doran and his staff. But you got to give Brissett credit with what he's done so far.
So Cole back out there to punt again.
A couple of three and outs we've seen.
Yep.
After the touchdown.
They got that quick touchdown, and then they kind of stalled on these next two possessions. But Eastern Kentucky has really shown no ability whatsoever to do anything with those advantages. Ball going to hit at the 24, roll three more yards, close to four more yards, and be downed at the 20-yard line. It's a 36-yard kick for the freshman Cole with 8:29 to play in the quarter. NC State has a 21-0 lead. After 2 hours and 16 minutes, the rain has finally arrived.
And it hailed off for quite some time, though. We almost got lucky.
And the crowd of 57,000 plus at kickoff capacity, many of them have scattered and run for the cars.
I'm trying to run for some overpass somewhere. Stay dry.
Mobley on the carry. NC State has done a really good job of shutting down the running game. Just 21 yards of rushing for the Colonels prior to that run right there by Mobley.
Yeah, and that's what's really disheartening, I think, for Eastern Kentucky, because they rely heavily on the run with DeShaun Mobley and what he can do. And we talked about Kentavious Hopkins at the start. Both of them had solid games last week, but unable to get anything going whatsoever.
Up top, far side, and Glover unable to come up with it. Burris shadowing him. And now it's going to be third down. Hopkins has not even gotten a carry tonight.
Didn't even touch the ball, but Glover has been the story for Eastern on offense. And just a little bit outside, a little bit too far outside for him to make the grab. But he's had an excellent game thus far. He's been kind of the one bright spot for Eastern Kentucky offensively.
Yeah, they've gotten the veterans, Burris and Stevens, matched up on him. Remember, he was getting the success against Niles, the younger corner, or the least or less experienced corner, perhaps I should say. So now third down and eight. Coney, ball batted down. Line of scrimmage. B.J. Hill was there. Hill's had him quite a night. A sack, three total tackles for loss. Now he bats down a pass.
Yeah, watch the big man get up here, number 98. He's going to jump and block this pass. Big man getting up off the ground. That's all 6'4", 300 pounds of him.
Guy's athletic.
He was upset that he didn't come up with the pick.
He would have took it to the house. Would have been a Sports Center top 10 again.
No,
for
I don't
NC State.
I don't see anybody bringing him down if he's got the football.
It's a train going.
Rusak lets it fly. Cherry back to the 25. Nice block. And another. Braylon Cherry cuts back and finally dropped at the 38-yard line by John Floyd.
We've talked about the special teams all day trying to have that edge go to Eastern Kentucky, but this time for NC State, they build that wall for Cherry, and man, it almost goes the distance. Again, for punt returns, it's all about building that wall, so you got to look at these blocks that are happening. Look at all these blocks that are happening on the edge. They build that wall enough for Cherry to be able to get in. You would have hoped that he would have just kept going straight instead of turning that ball up. He might have had a chance to take it to the house.
That was a tremendous block, and the Colonel that got blocked on the play is still down on the field.
You have got to have your head on a swivel on special teams, especially in the return game.
That's Joel Brown, who got shaken up on that play. And a big return by Braylon Cherry of 37 yards following a 53-yard punt. And the Wolfpack has it at the 37-yard line of Eastern Kentucky.
Big hit. Setting the tone on special teams. I tell you, you better have your head on the swivel on those in that kicking game.
No question.
You can get in trouble.
Joel Brown finally finds his way to the sideline and finds a
man.
spot on the bench to recollect, or rather regather his thoughts. Days run down in the hole.
And they are committed to the run. The Wolfpack most certainly is. Days has 18 carries in this game.
Aaron Patrick made that tackle. Now, Patrick is listed as the backup defensive end to Noah Spence. We have not seen Spence on the field now for a while, so Patrick in there.
See if we can get an update on Spence. Started off hot in the first quarter, but we've kind of lost him since. Now he's, in fact, out of the game.
And that's Patrick again making the tackle on the carry by Days again.
Freshman get an opportunity to play. Aaron Patrick there. 6'4", 235 pounds. He's a big man, too.
Brings up a third down and four from the 31. Days just 2 yards away from his second consecutive 100-yard gain. It would be the second of his career, coming on the heels of the 126 he ran for against Troy last Saturday. Not going to get it on that carry.
Lose a few there. Calvary comes in for Eastern Kentucky.
And fourth down here. Let's see if they go for it. It would be a long field goal attempt should they try that. Of close to 50 yards. Looks like they will go for it on fourth down. And a long four.
Hadn't seen Samuels much on this drive. He's number 28. Looks like he's at the top of your screen.
Wolfpack were 3-for-4 on their fourth downs last week against Troy. Completion, first down. Flag out, however, behind the line of scrimmage. That was Ramos.
Excuse me, that's
again
Ramos out
with
there
another
on the
big catch, but it might be erased.
Personal foul, roughing the passer.
Oh,
defense
wow.
Number four. 15-yard penalty. First down.
They get Devontae Derricott, the transfer from Kansas State. But Ramos continuing to shine at the wide receiver position. It's a nice in route stop there.
And even though you did not see the late hit on that replay, you knew that it was a late hit because the ball was gone and he still hadn't been hit.
So correction. Still hadn't been hit. Yeah.
Correction, half the distance.
So after our cameras were off the quarterback, he got hit. It was that late. So a half the distance and first goal to go for NC State from the 8-yard line. Days on the carry, and he's close. Stopped inside the one.
This offensive line for NC State has just been tremendous all night, giving Days opportunities here. I mean, he ran for 5 yards before he was even touched. Got to credit your offensive line doing work. See Alex Barr coming up a little.
And that's the one area NC State can desperately not afford any injuries. They are very thin on the offensive line. Everybody behind their starters is pretty much a redshirt freshman outside of the fourth-year junior Bryce Kennedy, who's a backup.
Yeah, and specifically at left guard, if you remember last week, Garrett Bradbury was injured as well. They lost him in that game as well. So now you got both left guards, number one and number two, have been knocked out of competition. So NC State very thin on the offensive line. When we talked with Coach Doran, that was his concern for his team in terms of moving forward, is building that offensive line depth. They've already lost two guys in the first 2 weeks here.
Well, it is number 56, Bryce Kennedy, who checks into the ball game at left guard to replace Barr. Second and goal from the one. And Brissett comes up under center. And Days tries to go up and over, and he gets in. Days with another touchdown. It's his second of the quarter as the Wolfpack take a 27-0 lead.
Keep feeding your playmaker the rock. Days goes over the top here, lands in the end zone, continuing to show why this guy is a dominant offensive player for the Wolfpack.
That's a six-play, 37-yard drive that was set up by Braylon Cherry's 37-yard punt return. PAT is perfect, and it is a 28-0 lead now for the Wolfpack as they have doubled up their lead here in this third quarter.
Yeah, you look at his numbers there. Second week over 100 yards, a couple of touchdowns here tonight. Had a touchdown last week, and it's been all Matt Days all day. When it was light out, he was making things happen on the ground, jump cutting back and forth and making guys miss in space. And then, of course, taking it the distance on this 25-yard run. And then taking it over the top. Hater. It's been all Days all day.
Yep. 232 yards rushing for Matt Days in his first two games this season, or half of his total for the entire season a year ago when he rushed for 573. Of course, last year, sharing those carries with Shadrack Thornton, who he will be sharing carries with going forward when Thornton comes off of his suspension next
week. Well, this really poses a nice problem, you know, for Dave Doran and his staff. What do? You have your returning starter from a year ago coming back into the fold, but you have your second string guy, Matthew Days, playing so well. What do? I mean, the balance there is going to be interesting to see as the Wolfpack move along.
And, of course, Jalen Samuels also, you know, becoming a greater part of the mix.
Yeah,
I tell you what you
man.
Do, you make defensive coordinators guess where the ball's going.
Yeah. That will definitely work in your favor.
Absenon takes the ball from the 5-yard line and up to the 21, a 16-yard return for Absenon.
Absenon, a guy we talked about at the top with the versatility of him in the all-purpose yards from a week ago and how effective he was in the kicking game. They have completely taken him away from having any impact in this game, which is impressive because he's a good player.
Yeah, Coney heads back out there. Eastern Kentucky down 28-0. What do you do if you're Eastern Kentucky to try to get something going here? It goes beyond X's and O's right now.
Yeah, it most certainly does. You're playing for pride now, right? You're playing for pride. You want to try to get something going, regardless of what it is. And I think for Eastern Kentucky, they got to put together some kind of drive, which they just have been unable to do. And it all starts with quarterback play. I mean, let's be honest here. Cooney has not had an excellent day. We've seen him struggle with the short passes. Yep. We've seen him struggle with the long balls as well.
But I would, in his defense, and he has not had a good day with his accuracy, they're losing the battle up front at the line of scrimmage, and they're just, you know, they're physically outmanned against that NC State defensive line. And I think that's becoming more and more evident as the night goes on, as Coney just has to heave that ball out of bounds rather than take a quarterback sack. He's really got no choice on that play right there.
Yeah, he's had a tough go so far in terms of having time to be able to find wide receivers. But again, this is times when your playmakers have got to step up and do something, and they're relying so much on Coney and what he can do.
Mobley has been out of the ballgame on this series with Adam Lane in their running back.
Remember, he's a transfer from Florida, just got to Eastern Kentucky in August.
Third down and 10, and Coney has to throw it away to save his life and avoid a quarterback sack.
Yeah, they tried to set up a screen there for Lane. You know, and you teach your offensive line in screens to sort of let the defender go, but that doesn't mean allow the guy to have a mad dash at the quarterback. There has to be some sort of attempt out of block to slow this guy down.
Slow him down a little bit so we can set up the play.
Something.
Locklear is now deep, replacing Cherry in the punt return formation back at the 35-yard line after Cherry had a 37-yard return on his last attempt that set up their fourth touchdown. Locklear retreating and gets out of a tackle right there. And down at the 31-yard line, as Eric Reed was able to come back after initially missing the tackle, he came back and on the second attempt got him on the ground.
NC State coming back out on offense here. You know, you're up four scores. Right now, conventional wisdom would say that you just want to run the football. You want to try to milk that clock as much as possible. With all the weapons on NC State, I wouldn't be surprised, you know, if they go at Ramos or throw deep to Samuels.
I
got a lot of options.
Yeah, and I wouldn't be surprised if we don't see Jalen McClendon in the fourth quarter. And that's Gillespie getting his first carry of the night. Reggie Gillespie, the freshman at a High Point, picked up about 4 yards on the play. Gillespie had 50 yards rushing last week against Troy. So it looks like Day's night might be done. And if it is, he went 22 for 106 and a couple of touchdowns.
Not a bad night. Not a bad night at all.
Second down and six. Gillespie on the carry again. Picks up about 4 on the play.
And you talk about some valuable experience for a freshman running back to have an opportunity to play in this game and go against the ones of Eastern Kentucky. You know, if you're a coach, that's what you're looking to do for your younger players. And we mentioned how young this NC State team really is. Only 10% of the roster are seniors. So they're desperate to get some of these younger players playing time so that they can develop in the type of players and stars that they think they can be.
Still no Noah Spence on the field for Eastern Kentucky. Don't know whether he got hurt or not in that first half, but we have not seen him, I don't think, at all in this second half. That's a first down carry for Gillespie as he gets 3 consecutive totes and moves the sticks.
And you talk about the difference for Eastern Kentucky and their defensive line without a guy like Noah Spence. I mean, he's 6'3", 261 pounds, but more importantly, he's an NFL type of defensive end. He's that type of guy where a year ago he could have been in the National Football
right.
League if he didn't have the issues off the field. So they desperately miss him not being out there.
Speaking of which, he has passed 12 drug tests over the last 11 months. That's part of the protocol so he can, you know, prove to the guys at the next level that he's beyond his problems. He ended up at Eastern Kentucky because of the great friendship that Dean Hood and Urban Meyer have. Urban Meyer, of course, the Ohio State coach. He and Dean Hood, childhood friends, going
yeah.
back to their youth. They were, in fact, both, they were in each other's weddings.
Yeah, yeah.
It was the first time Dean Hood said that Urban had ever called him about taking on a player.
Yeah. They normally don't talk shop that
yep.
way. You know, they're good friends, so they don't normally have those kind of conversations. But with what Spence went through in the failed drug test, Urban felt compelled to call his friend and say, hey, I got a guy for you. And what a find
yep.
for Eastern Kentucky defensively.
So second down and 9. Alston on the end around, close to the sticks, across midfield at the 48-yard line.
And you see NC State continuing to milk that clock, just letting it go down. Again, this is the play we typically see Samuels run. These in-arounds. An excellent job by Alston there, getting the first down. We're getting close to the first down, setting up a third and short situation. So many weapons for this Wolfpack.
This will probably be the final play of the third quarter. Well, that was the last play of the first quarter as they reset the
That'll
clock.
That'll do it.
Yep. NC State will turn around and move the other direction as we head to the fourth quarter. And the officials don't have to move the ball very far, about a couple of yards, and just put it on the other side of the 50. Well, NC State raises their hands high in the air.
That is the end of the quarter.
They say the fourth quarter will belong to them. We know that the third quarter belonged to them as they outscored Eastern Kentucky 14-0. They lead it 28-0. Start of the fourth quarter, NC State with a 28-0 lead on Eastern Kentucky. Matt Stewart along with former Notre Dame star running back Darius Walker. Third down and less than a yard here for the Wolfpack. Just on the other side of the 50. Quarterback keeper Brissett, flag dropped at the line of scrimmage.
See if someone might have got a little antsy, jumped off sides on either side.
Offside, defense, middle of the line, 5-yard penalty, results in a first down.
Well, they were getting the first down anyway
yep.
in that play, so not as big of an impact of that penalty there.
Well, earlier today, the Ohio Valley's Jacksonville State put a huge scare in Auburn, losing on the Plains in overtime. Eastern Kentucky picks second in the OVC behind Jacksonville State. Doesn't look like they're going to provide us with the same kind of drama unless they can come up with a big rally here in the fourth quarter. So first and 10, ball from the 43-yard line for the Wolfpack. And Day's back in there. He is not done for the night.
Going to let him continue to eat up some yards here.
So he'll get a shot at breaking his career best 126 that he had last Saturday against Troy. That was seven right there, giving him 113 on the night.
And I can tell you, as a running back, when you're feeling it and you feel like you're in the zone, you want to be out there. So this could very well have been a case where Days goes to Coach Dorn and says, hey, listen, I still want to go. Put me out there.
Samuels in motion. They'll throw it to him out there. Samuels makes one man miss and trips forward. Another first down. It'd be interesting to see how many first downs Samuels has picked up tonight.
Just himself.
That would be a great stat because it seems like every time he touches the ball, he's moving the sticks.
It certainly is, but the first downs are definitely in favor of NC State. They got 18 first downs with that one versus seven for Eastern Kentucky. So
Samuels has five catches for 63 yards to go along with three carries for 24. At Samuels again, another first down, and he sets him up first and goal to go.
Boy, he is really a weapon for this team. They can hand him the ball or throw it to him. But look at the splits here. I talked about this earlier. The splits that Eastern Kentucky is having, they're so far deep. Samuels didn't get hit till he was about 10 yards down the field because the splits are so deep for the corners and safeties right now. It's amazing.
112 yards of offense for Samuels tonight. 88 receiving and 24 rushing. First and goal to go. They spot it at the 7. Brissett on the quarterback keeper got knocked backwards that time. Devontae Derricott, the linebacker, and words exchanged and flags come out.
You got to be able to keep your head and keep your poise here.
Unsportsmanlike conduct, defense number 4. 15-yard penalty, correction. Penalty before it's half the distance to the goal line. Automatic first down.
This is the second penalty that Derricott has had. If you remember earlier, he had the late hit on Brissett. So he's going to come out of the game and have to think about it a little bit. You got to keep your cool. You're already down 4 scores. Again, a play where you had him stopped. It was over. No reason to push after the play, especially after you stopped him for a loss yep. there, a short game.
6 tackles on the night for Derricott as he goes to the bench. So first and goal to go from the 4. Gillespie got about a yard on the play. Chris Kelly, the linebacker, I think the first guy to hit him.
You know, this game for NC State offensively started so slow, and we've just really seen a different team in the second half. They have gotten back to what they do best, and that's running the football.
Now, the scoreboard says second down and goal, which I believe is correct. The yard marker says third down and goal.
The disconnect there.
Because the penalty, the unsportsmanlike conduct penalty, gave them an automatic first down.
Let's see if they get this right here. We just saw Matthew Days run into the game. On a second or third and goal, whichever it is, you got to expect him to get the ball.
Please reset the game clock. 25 seconds. Play clock, thank you.
Well, they still haven't corrected the down situation where they have a discrepancy between the scoreboard and the yard marker. but I believe it is second down, despite the fact it says third down down on the field. So we'll go with second down and goal right here. And now maybe the officials have seen it. Yep. Now they're going to fix it. There they go. Everybody in the stadium saw it, except the guys whose jobs it is to see it. Hey, they made mistakes too.
A little upset at that. Took so long to correct the mistake, but
Samuels in motion. Hand off to Days. And Days gets in for his third touchdown of the night. And all of them have come here in the second half.
And Samuels is the decoy here. We talked about him all night. He comes in motion, comes back, and tries to get a block. But the distraction was just enough for Matthew Days to get his third score.
So Days now with five touchdowns in the first two games this season after scoring 13 a year ago and ranking third in the ACC. PAT is on the money. And NC State, with a 14-0 lead at halftime, has put three touchdowns on the board here in the first 18 minutes of the second half and now lead it 35-0. We had a rain shower in the third quarter. It has subsided, and now here early in the fourth quarter, NC State has opened up a 35-0 lead on Eastern Kentucky. Wolfpack well on their way to a 2-0 start and win number five in a row dating back to last season. Kick will be non-returnable, so the Colonels will get it at the 25. And that gives us an opportunity to take a look at our Capital One Cup impact performance. And it's Matthew Days, 24 carries for 116 and three touchdowns.
Yeah, he's been electric all night. Eastern Kentucky, has not had an answer for him. He's been able to get into the end zone three times. And it's really been a combination of his ability as a runner and then also the offensive line opening up those holes. If you see a lot of his long runs, he's not touched for 5 or 6 yards. So you got to credit the offensive line for opening up some room for their electric running back to run.
Kyle Romano now in there at quarterback, and his first snap is a handoff to Kentavis Hopkins.
Finally, we see Kyle Romano. Now, we mentioned that at halftime that we could potentially see number nine come in, because Kyle's a guy who a few years ago actually won the starting job, but because of a concussion and he blew out his knee a year ago, he has lost the job, hasn't been able to win it back. But he was a guy who has some talent and can play, and won the job at one point.
Pass thrown, sharply thrown, and complete at the 29-yard line.
That screen play to the wide receiver, I don't know why it's in there.
It hasn't worked. Glover got dropped immediately after making that catch.
That play has not worked all night. We continue to see it.
And now it's third down and six. Only seven first downs for Eastern Kentucky the entire night. Only 106 yards of total offense the entire night. Third down and six. And time runs out.
Play a game. Offense, nine. 5 yard penalty, third down.
We've seen a number of delay games.
I don't know how that's happening. Yeah, I mean, the play clock is clearly in the quarterback's vision here. Unless he's not picking it up, but it's right there on the scoreboard, both ends about the same place. You're right, that's the second time. That's at least twice now they've taken a delay of game tonight. And Hopkins will not pick up the first down as he gets dropped at the 25. Gained only one on that play.
First time we've seen Hopkins in action tonight. Remember a week ago he had 7 carries for 60 yards and a touchdown in their big win last week. But they just haven't had many opportunities to run the football, and that's sort of been the case for Eastern Kentucky tonight.
Well, 9 days ago they beat Valpo, a non-scholarship program, 52-10. Tonight they're playing a team with 85 scholarship players, and it's made a big difference.
You think that's the difference?
It's been part, yes. Fair catch called for and made by Cherry at the 25-yard line. And that's where the Wolfpack will put it in play when we get back. Will they have a new quarterback? Eastern Kentucky made the change on that series. Will the Wolfpack do the same? We'll find out when we get back. You're watching the ACC on ESPN. Matt Stewart along with Darius Walker down to our final 8:52 here at Carter-Finley Stadium. NC State 35-0 lead. So first and 10, and Jalen McClendon in there, quarterback for the Wolfpack, as we had anticipated, as Gillespie gets the first carry of this series. And first up to the 33, games that are still in progress. Of course, Notre Dame held on, but bad news for the Fighting Irish. We'll get to that in a moment, as they beat Virginia 34-27. Still in progress, Duke leading NC Central. That's in Durham. Of course, NC Central also a school there in Durham as well. North Carolina laying it on. North Carolina A&T in Pittsburgh has opened up a 24-7 lead on Akron in the final 3 minutes of that ball game. But how about the bad news for Notre Dame today, despite the fact the ninth-ranked Irish got the win?
Yeah, they did, but they got it at a tremendous cost in Malik Zaire going down, the starting quarterback. He is out for the year with a broken ankle. So to lose him week two, that's going to be huge, and that's the story for the Irish moving forward.
Gillespie on the carry picks up the first down. Thomas Owens, the backup linebacker, making the tackle.
Again, these reps right now are so valuable for these young players. Should get a shot of McClendon. Getting quality reps right now. These are quality reps. It's all learning experiences for the young players.
McClendon, the redshirt freshman out of West Mecklenburg High School in Charlotte. Interesting story. He's now 6'5", 208.
Yeah.
Now, he is a tall drink of water. Was not always that way. When he was a freshman in high school, he was 5'9 and ran the triple option.
Okay, so
he was kind of grown out of it.
He was a small drink of water at one point.
He was a sip.
He was a shot glass for a little while.
His freshman year in high school, but he's turned into a tall drink of water.
You got to love it, though, for NC State having the opportunity to have some of these younger players play. You know, it was interesting when we talked with Dave Duren over the phone about the lack of seniors and if that had an impact on leadership of this team. But he was emphatic where he said, absolutely not.
McClendon, heavy rush from behind, has to get rid of it. Some pressure coming from the backside there.
Feel that pressure. The young quarterback needs to feel that, get out of that pocket, get rid of the football. Again, this is a learning opportunity for the young players.
Shaquille Prather, the third string defensive end behind Noah Spence, making that tackle. When trying to get some information on Spence, whether he's on the sideline just by coach's decision because it's a blowout, or was he hurt, but we have not seen much of him in the second half. I don't know that we've seen him at all in the second half.
Yeah, I don't think he's been out there.
So third down and long. McClendon rolling to his right and throwing. That is a complete and a first down. Nice catch for the first down by Maurice Morgan.
Maurice Morgan getting some action here. But look at the young quarterback rolling out and throwing a pass on the money. On the run, look at that. That wasn't the best spiral at all, but it got there. It might have got tipped there, but an excellent job by the young quarterback. Rolling out and hitting a wide receiver on a dime. You like to see it.
First and 10 from the 48. Hines with the catch, and Hines gets cut down at the 45-yard line after a 3-yard gain.
with a nifty move there, too. I'd like to see the young player make a guy miss in space like that.
Naheem Hines is the big-time prospect. He's a true freshman out of Garner, North Carolina, nearby Garner, North Carolina. He was a local high school football star there. In fact, his twin sister, Aya, is
on the track team.
But he's one of the big-time freshmen. That's one of the things Dave Doran told us. You know, obviously, they have improved the talent level here since he's been here over the last 3 years. That's Hines again, other side, same exact play. Got a nice block on the edge to free him up, and he'll pick up the first down inside the 35-yard line.
Again, these valuable reps for these young players. This is how you see your guys grow. Young hometown players. And when you talk recruiting, remember we talked with Dave Doran, about coming into NC State a few years ago, he really wanted to get those homegrown players out of North Carolina. You see the young players, how much a percentage of this roster that they actually make up. But specifically getting guys out of North Carolina, he was so upset about seeing the better players leaving the state to go play somewhere else.
And out of those 51 total freshmen, 30 are true freshmen.
So a lot of young players for this team.
Brady Bodine on the carry as NC State getting kind of deep on their roster now, giving some guys a chance to play that don't typically. You got Morgan, who made a catch here a few moments ago. Yeah. Bodine getting his first carry of the season. And he picked up 4 on that play, second down and 6, as we're under 5 minutes to play now. Bodine again. Want to look a little bigger picture now with NC State, Darius. They've won their first 2 home games of the season. They were supposed to do that. Beat Troy. They're going to beat Eastern Kentucky tonight. Mm-hmm. They now go on the road at Old Dominion and then at South Alabama. Again, games they're going to be expected to win.
Yeah.
Their first big test comes on October 3rd against a Louisville team. They'll host the Cardinals here. But Louisville suddenly 0-2 on the season.
Yeah, they're not having a good year right now. And it's the exact opposite for NC State, as they're going to be 2-0 after this game. And so you got to be excited if you're Dave Doran for your team. And specifically, we talked about those week one mistakes and them making them here today. Hopefully they can get all that out of their system over the next 3 or 4 games before they get a chance to see them.
Third down incompletion. And here's a look at the entire schedule for NC State. You see the 2 road games coming up, and then things get serious as they jump into their ACC schedule, and they play in the very deep water of the Atlantic Division, the toughest division in the Atlantic Coast Conference. And by anybody's estimation, they would be a dark horse candidate, a long shot to win that division. But tonight will be their 5th win in a row dating back to last season.
Yeah, you talk about momentum, and that's what you can do, all you really can do. And the fact that they're getting valuable reps for their young players makes it all even better.
McClendon scrambling, and he'll step out of bounds at the 23-yard line, and he got enough for the first down. That's a savvy play right there. Saw the marker on the ground. Let me get 1 foot past it and step out of bounds, and that's what he did.
Again, I realize he's a young player, but this is all recognition. Nobody's open. You see the sticks. Know you can get to him, take off, and run. That's a smart play from a young quarterback.
So first and 10 for the Wolfpack at the 22-yard line as they are driving towards what they hope would be their 6th touchdown of the night. Nothing doing right there. Prather with another tackle. Now the story for Eastern Kentucky, they're going to have a couple of weeks off before they start their OVC schedule. They'll be playing Austin-Peay on September 26 after tonight's ball game, off next week.
Bodine, he's got an injury here. He's down. See the young player get up. Get off the field on his own power. But yeah, for Eastern Kentucky, you know, we mentioned it at the top. They're picked to finish behind Jacksonville State in the Ohio Valley Conference. So they had their big win a week ago. Not going to get a win here today.
But the question for them is the quarterback position. Can they find a guy? Is that guy Benny Coney?
Second down. Ball thrown complete.
Reggie Gillespie there. Standing in the game, continuing to get some action.
Under 2.5 to play.
But I think for NC State in this game, you know, we talked about how they got off to a slow start. They've had the penalties, which they didn't have last week. And hopefully for them, a lot of those mistakes and those nuances that happened early in the season are already over with.
And I think another thing is they go back and they kind of do the the autopsy on this ball game, for lack of a better word. They go back and study it and pick it apart. I mean, they're going to finish very close to a balanced attack. They're 199 on the ground right now, 244 in the air. Of course, last year they finished within 7 yards of their passing and rushing totals for the entire year.
Yeah, you really couldn't do that if you tried. I mean, that just kind of happened for them. But they really want to have that balanced offensive attack. You know, when we spoke to Matt Canada, that's what he said. Like, listen, balance is what we have, and we have options. And you see those options today in Samuels and Days and Ramos playing well.
They rushed for 251 last week against Troy. They're at 199 here right now with under 2 minutes to play. They rushed for over 200 yards per game last season. That was the first time since 1992 that they had rushed for over 200 yards a game on average for an entire season. McClendon throws incomplete.
Drop there. But yeah, when you have running backs like what NC State has, and Matthew Days, the emergence of Matthew Days, and Shadrick Thornton, hadn't seen him yet. He'll be back next week after coming off the suspension. So a lot of positives for this team. And really the question going forward for NC State is going to be that offensive line and that depth. I mean, we've seen them lose two guys in Alex Barr and Garnett Bradbury the first 2 weeks of the season.
Right.
So depth has already been an issue. Now you lose two guys. That's going to be the question moving forward.
Well, yeah, and we don't know the severity of Barr's injury for sure. We saw him walk off the field today. McClendon has to throw it away on fourth down, and the ball will go over on downs with 1:25 to play.
No intentional grounding. The quarterback was beyond the box. The ball finished.
So the Colonels get one more crack at it before we close things down here at Carter-Finley Stadium. But just the improvement that Doran has made in this program, and we started this night off by talking about how much the Wolfpack loved to run the ball in the year before, and we'll tell you about that in just a moment when we come back and wrap things up from Raleigh, North Carolina. ...35-0 NC State, down to our final 1:25 here in Raleigh, North Carolina, as Eastern Kentucky goes back on offense, probably for the final time tonight. Romano out there at quarterback again, wrapping this game up for the Colonels. Hopkins on the carry. Going back to what I was talking about before the break, just the great improvement that this NC State team has made in their running game since Doran took over. And the year before he got here, in 2012, the Wolfpack averaged only 111 yards on the ground. Last year, they averaged 204. This year, through their first two games, they're averaging 225. So they have doubled their per-game rushing totals in just 3 short years under Doran.
Well, it most certainly helps when you have the weapons that we've seen that NC State has had, but you got to give Doran credit for turning the program around. And really, another key number is the time of possession that they continue to exude, because they get first downs and they run the football so effectively.
Hopkins on the carry. That might have been our final play.
Could be it, but it's all about controlling the clock for them on offense, and they've been able to do that the last few weeks. Now, again, we mentioned it against Troy and here today against Eastern Kentucky. These are games you're supposed to win, but at the same time, you want to play really, really well, and you want to win by those big margins. And we've seen NC State take care of business, which has got to be encouraging for Dave Doran and his staff.
Well, it appears that Eastern Kentucky has decided to call it a night. as Dave Dorn makes his way across the field to shake hands with Dean Hood. And it is a final from Raleigh, where the North Carolina State Wolfpack improved to 2-0 in the season. Fifth consecutive win dating back to last year. A 35-0 shutout of Eastern Kentucky here tonight. And we'll come back and wrap things up from Carter-Finley Stadium right after this timeout. NC State, the victory over Eastern Kentucky tonight here at Carter-Finley Stadium. Matt Stewart along with Darius Walker. And, I mean, this was a tight ball game at the end of the first half. 14-0. Eastern Kentucky had it first and goal to go at the two, a chance to punch it in, cut this thing to 14-7. Yeah. Big defensive stand, in particular defensive sack by Mike Rose. And from there, it was all North Carolina State in the second half.
That was kind of the defining moment of the game, because they had an opportunity to go into halftime 14-7, which is a completely different game. But we saw a different NC State team when they came out, because they opened it up and really put their foot on the gas.
And how about Matt Day? Second consecutive game, Days goes over 100-yard rushing, filling in for, you know, Shadrack Thornton, who's still serving that suspension. Days made the most of his opportunity these first 2 weeks of the season.
And that's the thing. This is the second-string running back, and you've seen him just have two electric days in last week and in this week. I mean, he scored three touchdowns today, as you see him, over 100-and-something yards. So he played an excellent day.
Yeah, and you see a big second half with NC State outscoring Eastern Kentucky 21-0. Jacoby Brissett, a very quiet 17 for 22. That's a good line.
Yeah.
That's
a
good line. Yeah. Only five incompletions, 216. Days 24 for 116. Ramos had a big first half, seven catches for 95. And don't forget about Samuels. Yeah. He had 88. He had 88 receiving yards and over 100 yards of offense.
You talk about the balance of this offense. You got to be impressed if you're Dave Doran, because he's got so many weapons that he can use. It's going to be a good year for them offensively.
And you get Shadrack Thornton back next week when you go on the road and you play at Old Dominion. And then you've got at South Alabama, and then back here for Louisville for your ACC opener in 3 weeks.
Yeah, they really do. So they got to get this thing together. But what we did see today from NC State was some issues in the beginning. The penalties that we didn't see a week ago against Troy, but you got to give them credit. They came out the second half and made it a different game.
North Carolina State gets the 35-0 win over Eastern Kentucky, and the Wolfpack now 2-0 on the season. To see a replay of this entire game, you can log on to the ESPN app and ESPN.com. And now for Darius Walker and our entire ESPN 3 crew, I'm Matt Stewart saying so long from Raleigh, where the Wolfpack win it 35-0. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports.